Good morning. Welcome. I'm Mindy Tate. I'm Executive Director of Franklin Tomorrow, and we want to welcome you this morning to Frank Talks. This is our monthly lecture series. It's held across the community, different locations, always on the second Monday of the month, and it helps us fulfill our mission. Franklin Tomorrow's mission is to engage the community, foster collaboration, and then advocate for a shared vision for the future of Franklin. And by having conversations like this, we're able to fulfill that mission. And so we really appreciate you being here and being part of the conversation. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter, social media, as well as visit our website so you can stay informed about our events. And if you pre-registered for today, we'll make sure that you're on our email list and get our usually twice a month emails about events and activities that are coming up. So I'm going to turn it over now to Franklin Tomorrow's Board President, Tim Murphy, who'll tell you a little bit about today's program before we get started.
Thanks, Mindy. Good morning, everybody. As Mindy said, this is Frank Talks for November, and it's making a difference with young leaders. I just want to take a minute to thank some of our partners. First, the Vanderbilt University Office of Community, Neighborhood, and Government Relations, along with Lynn Maddox, who always is very helpful to us with partnering through Vanderbilt. And of course, we want to thank our host, West Haven, and Mary Lee Bennett. And so with that, our final Frank Talks, and I don't think Mindy said that a minute ago, our final one for the year, for 2017 this year, will be on December the 11th, and it'll be held at Columbia State Community College. So put that on your calendar, or be sure to get us your contact information, and as Mindy said, we'll let you know when we've got events and things coming up. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Mary Lee. Mary Lee Bennett.
Good morning, everybody. We're so fortunate to have these three great people with us this morning. And I first would like to introduce them to you. From over on the far side there is Diane Hughes with the Youth Leadership Council. Diane Hayes has been a native of Nashville and a graduate of the University of Tennessee. Go Vols. She began her career at Siegenthaler Public Relations and became the Director of Public Relations at the Hyatt Regency in Nashville. From there, she went to the State Department of Economic Development in 1983 as an assistant to the commissioner. After that, she joined Governor Lamar Alexander's staff as Director of Special Projects for a statewide heritage, tourism, and community economic development promotion, Tennessee Homecoming 86. These are some big things that she's done. From there, she produced 18 statewide events and projects to include traveling musical production, Coming Home Tennessee, the Tennessee Journalism Reunion, the Tennessee Literary Festival, and the 1986 Liberty Football Classic Halftime Show. Wow. No. What a great adventure. Afterwards, Diane has worked independently and was hired to coordinate and manage such programs and events as the first Southeastern Festival of Books. In 1987 and 88, the Liberty Bowl Football Classic Halftime Shows, Metro Nashville Arts Commissioner First Grants Program, and Very Special Arts Tennessee-wide, statewide program. In addition, she was an instructor in mass communications in Middle Tennessee State University from 1986 to 88, and in fashion merchandising at O'More College of Design from 83 to 85. In 1992, she became the director of marketing for the Tennessee Department of Tourism Development, and later as the director of community development, creating a new heritage cultural tourism development division there. Diane, thank you for joining us. I hardly think so. Zach Wolfson, I had the pleasure of meeting this morning after knowing his mother for quite some time, so that was a pleasant surprise. Zach is the founder and executive director of Threads of Care. He's also an international baccalaureate student at Franklin High School. He's on the varsity cross country and is a half marathon runner. So he has very little free time is what I can see. He also is a mock trial competitor. He's written multiple blog posts to raise awareness about teen poverty and has been featured as a guest writer in the Nashville Business Journal. He also likes long walks on the beach and watching the sunset over the horizon. Me too, Zach. Casey Enright is the founder and executive director of the Word Wagon, which is a literacy organization dedicated to promote childhood literacy by providing reading opportunities and reading materials for children who lack access to books. So you can see some common threads here, can't you? Casey is a recent graduate of Belmont University studying faith and social justice, participating in Belmont Wesley Fellowship, and now serves on the worship team at the Village in Nolensville. God placed the mission of the Word Wagon on Casey's heart as a junior in college, and she is continually in awe of what God is doing for the Word Wagon. Fun things about Casey include she loves to read and sing. Her favorite weather is warm. Me too. And she could eat a whole box of goldfish by herself. So we're so pleased to have them here with us this morning. So I'm going to hand the mic over to Casey first and ask each of them to tell us all about their organizations that they've developed at such a young age.
Good morning, everyone. Can everybody hear me? Well, I am so glad to be here this morning, and I am the executive director of the Word Wagon, and the Word Wagon is a literacy organization where we are dedicated to promoting childhood literacy by providing reading opportunities and reading materials for children who lack access to books. And so what that looks like for us is we will hold reading days, which essentially would look like maybe if we were here in the parking lot, popping up a tent, having a bookcase, chairs, and carpets for kids to sit on, and wonderful books that have been donated all throughout the community for the children to enjoy and then take home after they've read with us. So we're very much a hand up rather than a handout model. So we don't want to simply just give out the books. We want to engage with the kids. We want to connect with them, and so that they know that reading is fun. Reading is not just a chore, it's not just an assignment at school, but it's something that provides an opportunity. And so we want to make sure that they know that again, so that reading is fun, but it also provides them to work through something that they're going home, you know, dealing with, and so that they can connect with the story. They can just grow and love the books that are that we're blessed to have in our home, like I was when I was younger, but some of these kids don't. And so what we do is we provide that opportunity for the kids to read with us. And we started in October of 2015. Like Mary Lynn said, I was a junior in college when I started it. And I had learned that 1 out of 300 children in a low-income neighborhood have access to an age-appropriate level book. I'm going to say that one more time because that was just so astounding to me when I heard that 1 out of 300 children in a low-income neighborhood have access to an age-appropriate level book. So if you remember the Brown Bear by Eric Carle, that would just be one of these per 300 kids have access to that, which broke my heart, and I said, we got to fix that. So that's when it hit me that we thought, what about a mobile library, going into communities, sitting down with these kids, reading. And since that day in October of 2015, we haven't stopped reading. And we've, in fact, traveled close to 3,000 miles reading with kids all over Middle Tennessee, speaking with people about the Word Wagon. We've read with over 300 kids, distributed over 1,500 books, and held close to 40 reading days. So I'm very excited to continue to share with you all this morning about what we're doing with the Word Wagon.
Okay. All right. Wow. First of all, could you just give her a round of applause? That's freaking awesome. All right. Well, my name is Zach Wolfson. I'm the executive director of Threads of Care. Now, what we focus on doing is establishing a group of teens, helping teens one thread at a time. Now, what that looks like is making sure that we raise a bunch of money, we run a bunch of fundraisers. We also do clothing drives all throughout Williamson County high schools and other parts of Tennessee. And also, we like to raise awareness about teen and child poverty in the Franklin area as well as in the Nashville area. And specifically, when I talk about raising awareness, I think one of the things that we don't talk about a lot in Franklin is poverty. We're considered to be one of the wealthier counties in the country, but the problem with that is that there are a lot of people here that aren't even having their basic necessities met when they go to school. If you look, for example, at Franklin Special School District, you'll learn that a lot of kids are actually going there and they're on free and reduced lunch. Now, what that means is that those students, generally speaking, are only having the meal that they get at school be the only meal that they actually get during the day. And that is one of the few basic needs that they're actually able to have met. A lot of these kids don't have anything but the clothes that they have on their back. They don't have new shoes. They're not able to participate in regular school activities that many of us may have been able to. A lot of these students are completely disregarded because, again, we just assume that Williamson County is a place where they can just prosper like a lot of people do here. And so one of the things that we try to do is make people aware of what's going on with that, and we do that through blog posts. In fact, to date we've written over 33. And we also do that by using social media such as Twitter and Instagram. And in fact, if you guys want to check us out later, you can just type Threads of Care on Instagram or Twitter, and that would really help us out and spread our message. Now, when we run clothing drives, one of the things that I've found is that nonprofits find it very difficult to get a foothold in high schools. And this is because individual districts tend to have their own specific rules and regulations on which specific organizations can come in and get things done. But I found that when students are actually doing the work and then acting as a middleman for a lot of other nonprofits that help homeless teens and impoverished youth in Nashville and Franklin, it's actually a situation where we're able to do a lot of good, because high schoolers are very much willing to work with high schoolers. So we're able to contribute in that way and essentially fill a need which otherwise would not be able to be met by these nonprofits, at least typically. And again, when I talked about fundraising earlier, we usually will do that by applying for grants. And when we end up acquiring those grants, we like to provide micro donations to different nonprofits and school boards throughout Williamson County and Nashville. So for example, recently we received a $500 grant from Disney, which we will be working to distribute to purchase clean underwear and socks, because that's kind of the thing that you can't really donate in a drive, at least. I mean, you wouldn't want to receive anything that's used for that, right? All right, so so we're going to use that to purchase brand new underwear and socks, and we're also going to use that to donate to some of our partners, such as the Franklin Special School District, such as the Oasis Center. And so that's what we do with our fundraising, and we also like to partner with local businesses to work on that too. And it's been an amazing journey so far. And, you know, every single person I work with, our student leaders, who we call ambassadors, they're just absolutely, it's just heartwarming to see how they give back to their community. And it's amazing to see people that are high schoolers willing to go and serve other teens to show that they really do care. And I think that it spreads a very powerful message that hopefully we can spread throughout the rest of Williamson County and increase this need to serve others. That's what my personal goal is. And so I'm looking forward to see how we can do that. And I'm looking forward to share more with you guys today.
Hi, I'm Diane Hayes, and I'm the Executive Director of the Young Leaders Council. And the Young Leaders Council has been around quite a while, since 1985, and in Nashville especially. And our main purpose and mission is to train young professionals 25 to 40 years old to serve on the board of directors of nonprofit organizations. And the program consists of 11 training classes, with all the topics having to do with something of the fundamentals of serving on a board. And then after that, everyone who participates gets placed on one of the boards of their choice to do a one-year internship as a non-voting member of the board. And with the hopes at the end of that year, they'll be asked to stay on that board as a full voting member. And then after that, they become one of what we call our alums, and we hold activities for them also so that they'll stay in touch with us, because they are our greatest resource, that we have all these wonderful young professionals that are out there on boards and that I call on for 100 million different things. And so that's our program in a nutshell, is the training classes, the internship, and then they become one of our alums. And in fact, I have several alums here that are in the Williamson County, and somebody who was in the Nashville class are here today. So that's cool to get to see them. And Carmen was the one that asked me to come today, and she's one of our alums and in the present current class that's going on, because after the Nashville had a class for two classes a year for many years, then Williamson County, the chamber, asked us to come and start one here in Williamson County, exactly like the one in Nashville, and that was 4 years ago. This is our fourth year, and it is blossomed and bloomed this year. We hold the classes in the Williamson County Chamber, but we're about to outgrow that room there, so we'll have to look for other places, but that's a good problem. And then we also have a class with the Junior League in Nashville, and we also have just started a class with the Massey Graduate School of Business alums. So we're pretty hopping busy. It was small when I started, but it's not so small anymore, which is a wonderful thing. And when I look at Casey and Zach, some people their age, you have to explain to them, not just their age, people grown, what is the difference in a nonprofit and a profit? What does a nonprofit board do? What does a nonprofit do? You know what? And they're founding one, and now they're running one. So that's so impressive. But that's the greatest part that I get to see, is that young professionals, a lot of times not quite as young as Casey and Zach, which is, as I said, impressive, but young professionals are wanting to give back to the community and wanting to make a name and a legacy for themselves in helping others, and that is really a fun thing to get to see all the time. So that's what I do at Young Leaders Council and what Young Leaders Council does. Yeah, sure. Actually, anyone who wants to go online and apply, go to our website and apply, is that are 25 to 40 years old, are welcome to. And so once we get their application, then we call them and let them know we received it, and then we set up a time for me to meet with them in person, not as an interview, because by that time, by the time somebody cares enough to call and to apply and is willing to come meet, for Young Leaders Council, that means they have a heart for it, and that's what they want to do. And most of the time what I hear is that they say, I've been looking for something like this, and then someone told me in this, that's just what I want, you know. And that's the way we grow. It's really more of a one-on-one kind of thing rather than, because it has to be coming from in here. And so once that we meet, then we'll put the class together, and it'll start, you know, at a certain time, like the spring class in Nashville will start the first Wednesday in March, and there's a deadline to apply. And then the fall class starts in the fall, of course, at the first Wednesday in October. And then the Williamson County class is always in the fall. It's one time a year. So when we meet, we just talk about what the program is about, and they ask questions, and I make sure they understand it all. And then we do have a waiting list in Nashville, but if they don't get in the first class they apply for, then they know that 99% they're going to be in this next class. But Williamson County class hasn't reached full capacity yet, even though it is growing so much, so there's not a waiting list for the one in Williamson County. But anyway, so go online and apply, and then you'll hear from us, and then you'll get all the scoop on the classes, and you'll have time to ask questions if it's anyone in here that's interested.
Zach, could you talk a little bit about what inspired you to start Redskin?
Well, it started with a trip that we had a couple years ago when I was a lot younger, when we were in New York City, and it's a really beautiful place to go, but one of the things that I noticed, at least beyond all of the shining lights and stuff like that, and in Times Square and all these beautiful things, is that when you just take a look to your left or right, and you look down an alleyway or something, or you look in some kind of alcove, you see a lot of disparity between what you see on the billboards and then what you see actually on the street. And so at one point we were rounding a corner, and then I look to my right and I see this kid. He's just lying there, and I don't know, he was about the same age as I was, and there was something about that to me that just seemed fundamentally just wrong, man. And so when I see this kid lying here, I'm like, as a young kid, I mean, the first thing I think is that what's going on here? For me, I was more confused, and really this is an issue that bothered me for a very long time. So in middle school, I thought, all right, well, if there are people that are just like me who don't have the opportunity to be able to have a comfortable lifestyle and to be able to engage in an education and be able to have a good life, the very least I can do is do something to help them. So what I did was I started a coat drive. It was pretty simple at first. I just put a bunch of flyers around school and I said, hey guys, I'm running a coat drive. We are doing this to help homeless teens in Nashville. And that's actually when I first got my connection to the Oasis Center and when I first got my connection to Tom Ward, who was the CEO there. So I started doing that. It felt really great. We actually collected at that time around 70 coats. So it was a small number, but it was a start. And I thought, well, I've got a chance to be pretty effective here. So I did that throughout middle school. And then once I get to Franklin High School, freshman year, completely brand new start for me, because I've left from BGA to Franklin, and so I don't know anybody. So the first year, I kind of just get adjusted there. But then come sophomore year, I figure I want to do this again, because this is something I had a lot of success with. And so I ran another coat drive. And that time, we collected a little bit over 100. I'm like, okay, I've been able to do a lot here. But then I thought, well, if these high schools have such incredible potential for collecting clothing, then what if we could get this going on in other high schools? So at the end of my sophomore year, I thought, well, that would be really cool, but what am I actually going to do to actually make a bigger impact? So over the summer, I went to this place called the Hugh O'Brien Youth Leadership Seminar, and I show up there, and I think, okay, I'll try and share the same feelings that I had being able to serve people that are just like me, but by the roll of a dice, have ended up in a different situation. I'll try to share that same feeling with other people and see if I can get some people on board. So I got a few people interested, and come junior year, I was working over the summer on a name, on a website, on making sure that we had the right procedures in place, and then Threads of Care was born. And we've been growing tremendously, especially over my junior year last year, and we're growing even more this year. Right now we have over 180 members, 20 student leaders, and to date, we've collected over 7,300 articles of clothing and raised over $3,500. And so that is so much more than the initial 100 coats that I collected back in high school and the initial 70 that I collected in middle school. And so just to be able to do that and to find teens that share that same passion that I had back in middle school, who care, that's something that's really just, I don't know, it's just, it's hard to really put into words, but it's just incredibly heartwarming. And you know, it's one of those things, serving people that are just like you, but by random circumstances have ended up in complete disparity. There's just something so fundamentally heartwarming and special about that. It fills me up every day, honestly, and I don't know. It's what made me start this thing. It's what made a lot of our teen leaders decide to start these chapters up in their schools, and it's one of the things that's keeping me going. And so it's an honor to be able to serve them, and it's a really great experience.
So Casey, why don't you talk a little bit about how you got started?
Yes. So I shared the statistic earlier, 1 in 300 children have access to an age-appropriate little book. That really was the fuel of the fire to create the Word Wagon. And I had also learned that over the summer, kids with resources that they don't have in their home, but maybe at school, but can't access those in the summer, they experience what's called a summer setback. And so if they aren't reading during the summer, as much as they have been in the school year, it's hard for them to keep on track with their other peers that have those resources at home. And so from learning the lack of access and realizing that if I could get access to these books through donations, how then can I get that to the kids through reading with them and then sending them home with books? And so that was really the inspiration behind thinking of what if we had a mobile library where we went into these communities and we read with the kids. And I had the idea on a Wednesday night to think of a mobile library. But then I kind of had a squirrel moment, thought about something else. But then the next day in a history class, my professor said simply the word literacy. And that just, it was a light bulb moment. I tore out a piece of paper and I just started writing down notes and even drawing out what it would look like to have a truck that could be that mobile library, whether a truck or a school bus where you can outfit it with shelves and put books in there. And what would that look like? And I'm not an artist and somehow sketched this out, but that's a dream that we have from learning that these kids don't have access to these books. And so I had that idea on a Thursday, pitched it to my mom and was like, what does this look like? What do you think this should be? And she said, I know exactly who you need to talk to. And we met with Chris Whitney, who's the founder of One Generation Away. They do an amazing work doing food distributions for families who are in these low-income neighborhoods or in these food deserts that lack access to really good quality food. So we met with him on the following Wednesday. So this is now a week from when I've had the idea initially. And we said, what would it look like if we came and read with the kids that are in the lines with the families while they're getting the food? So we talk a little bit more about it. And he said, that would be great. And in fact, the next week on a Friday, we have a food distribution. Why don't you come along? And I said, yeah, that sounds great. We'll absolutely be there. And after the conversation, I went, okay, hold on. I have no books, no tent, none of the details worked out. So it was the scariest, but it was the best yes that I could have made. So through that, we went from idea mode to execution mode in a matter of 2.5 weeks and just have never stopped running since then and reading with amazing children. And so that's kind of the fuel behind it, to learn that kids don't have wonderful books to read, to treasure, to curl up and read, you know, if it's warm outside or by the fire if it's cold. And so on that first day, I realized I didn't have any details worked out, but I collected 100 of my childhood books. We borrowed a tent from my pastor, and we went off and read right here in Franklin, and we read with 12 kids that first day, and it was an incredible morning. And for it to have gone from idea to execution mode that fast, I knew something is really precious here, something's very special, and we need to keep going. So that's why we've continued to read more. We now have a founding board that is just incredible, and we've applied for our 501c3 status. And if you had told me when I first started college that I would graduate, start a nonprofit, do all of that, I would have said, okay, that sounds nice. What is a nonprofit? I don't understand what that means. But now I can't imagine doing anything else. Every time that we read with the kids and get to send them home with books, it's just an incredible feeling. Yes. So our greatest resource needs, as I just mentioned, how we've started or we've applied for 501c3 status, I would say our funds are the biggest needs that we have. Our dream is to get to that point in which we can have an old school bus or an old food truck and outfit it that it's a library where we can go into these communities, park for a few hours, make those connections with the families that they know that we're coming, they know that we're reading. And something that I also want to share with you all, the books that we get are all donated, as I said, all throughout the country. We've gotten books from not just in Williamson County, Davidson County, Rutherford County, But we've also gotten a box from New York from people hearing about us, from Denver from people hearing about us, from Kentucky. And that's been an amazing opportunity to open those boxes, and they're full of books. That's wonderful. And so this bundle is something that a child gets to take home after they've read with us. And so, you know, the resources that we have through books is wonderful, and we get all of those donations. But now, as we are really, really becoming a nonprofit organization and continuing to grow, the funds would be the biggest resource gap that we are experiencing right now.
All right, so for the biggest resource gap that Threads of Care is currently facing, we've had a lot of really good support, at least in the local community in Franklin and Williamson County. And so that's been tremendous. But what we really want to do is make sure that we can spread more across the state of Tennessee. Now, we've already started to have some new student ambassadors in places like Memphis and places like Oak Ridge. So we've already started to expand. But what we're especially looking to do right now is make sure that we can get those good connections to make sure that we spread all across Tennessee and eventually start to branch out to other parts of the Southeast. And so that's actually where a lot of people in this room can help out. Just tell anybody you know about Threads of Care. Tell your siblings. Tell your parents. Tell your friends. Tell your dog. Tell anybody that you possibly can. It's really, that's the number one thing that we need right now. And so, if you can really just start doing that, if you can look us up on Google, if you can check out our social media page, that would be just tremendous, because the more community support we have, the more of a groundswell there is, the more that we can actually raise awareness for our cause and show that there are teens out there that are willing to help other teens. And I think that that's a really powerful message, and that's shown by the fact that I'm able to sit here and represent my organization today. But again, we always have room to grow, and I think that that's another really, really great opportunity that I think could be met, and it could very well start in this room. Also, I wanted to make a lot of you aware that this week we are starting a shoe drive. Now, a lot of those shoes are going to go to places like the Oasis Teen Center in Nashville, to places like Room in the Inn, as well as the nonprofit in Nashville, Souls for Souls. And so, again, if you can just spread the word about that, see if you know any high school counselors or any people across Williamson County that can provide pairs of shoes to donate, that would be tremendously helpful, because we're trying to collect as much as possible, because in the end, shoes fit within that same niche as clothing, and it's absolutely essential. Again, going back to when I was talking about a lot of the kids in Franklin Special School District, a lot of these kids at Freedom Intermediate, for example, they won't have the necessary shoes for gym class, or they won't have the necessary shoes to even go to school appropriately, and they won't be able to be in dress code. So by providing these basic needs to them, it provides them tremendous help and allows Franklin School District's board to focus on educating these students without having to worry if they're going to have their most basic needs met. So yeah, if you guys can actually help out with that, that would be amazing. And also, I'm going to be here for a few minutes after FrankTalks, so if anybody would like to have a conversation, I would absolutely love to.
Yes. We try to keep up with that to see, you know, once they start their internship, I lose touch with them, kind of. They don't want to stay in touch with me, you know, which thank goodness they do most of the time, but it just becomes a process, which is great. They do their internship on their board and then hopefully go on that board. And I send them surveys, and many of them answer, and it looks as if probably I would say about 75% are asked to stay on the board once they complete their internship, but not all of them are, because maybe, and it's not an obligation on either side, the intern doesn't have to stay on that board because maybe there's a reason why they're going to another board or something, and the nonprofit doesn't have to keep them. So it's between the nonprofit and the intern to decide whether they're staying on as a full board member. And so I would say 75% of the people are asked to stay on, and they do. And then I hear quite often of ones that go from an intern, then they become a full board member, and then they become an officer, and then they become the chair, and that happens quite a bit. And we have some pretty illustrious alums that have been on boards for many years now, because like I said, we started in 85, so we're not brand new by any means. But a lot of, and those of you in here who are on boards, you know really all you have to do if you're a board member and you're going and you say, I'll do that. Well, pretty soon, before you know it, you're the secretary, and before you know it, you're the treasurer, and before you know it, so that's what happens so much with the, and the biggest challenge, believe it or not, and this is why we were founded, is because a lot of times people on boards are over 45, 50, and sometimes lose sight of what a person 25 to 40 can bring to the board, believe it or not. And there are so many nonprofits now in Nashville and in Williamson County, all over. They need a lot of board members, and they need ones that are trained, which is really unusual, and they need ones that are enthusiastic and are creative and think out of the box, like the two great young people here. And so they're beginning to realize that. Older board members are beginning to realize that, hey, we need more than just people that are 50 and older. And you know how, why that was, because it's all about money. And so they thought that young professionals and young people didn't bring money to the board. But that's not true anymore. You know, there are a lot of ways to raise money without coming out of someone's pocket, with events and asking their company, because most of these young professionals going through young leaders are bankers, lawyers, CPAs, financial investment people, I mean, all across the board of occupations. And so they know how to get out there and raise money. And that's why a lot of boards are starting their own young professional advisory board, or sometimes they call it a junior board, because they want them to start have the energy and the ideas to have fundraisers and events and then make money for the senior board. So that is, you know, that's a great thing when somebody wants to, a nonprofit recognizes the talents of a young professional. And because they have a year to get to know them, and they ask to be, you know, they ask, the intern asked to be on, do their internship on that board. So they had to have some potential passion. And so, and then also they're trained, as I said, it's unusual. So usually it works out to be a good match, and that's how that happens.
I'll just talk about Franklin Tomorrow's experience with Young Leaders Council. We had several interns from Young Leaders Council, and some have gone on to be on our board, and others had career changes in their time frame of when they were our intern. It's been very positive for us because they are trained. They know what board service means. A lot of times people go on a board of directors for a nonprofit because somebody asks them. But they may not know what that fully means, what the job is. And this is a time of the year when a lot of nonprofits are looking for new board members. And so having someone who's gone through the process and understands some of the basics of nonprofit is so important. And also understands the commitment that you make when you agree to be on a board. We also, though, we have a lot of committees that work on our events and our structure. And so a lot of times people go on a committee first before they come on our board. Our board, Franklin Tomorrow's board, is a 25-member board of directors, which is relatively large for a nonprofit. So I just wanted to add that to the discussion about how important that is in having someone who has a passion but also has a knowledge of what it means to be a nonprofit board member. And that'll serve, as you all go forward, that'll be important. Zach, I wanted to ask about, you have all the Williamson County high schools represented in Threads. Do you have all the Williamson County high schools represented in Threads? Or?
No, currently we do not have all of the high schools. That's something that we are always trying to work out. So, for example, we have Independence High School, Franklin High School, of course, because that's where I go, Brentwood, Page. But we're always looking to expand and, again, get more people in Williamson County. And so we want to get a lot of people in Williamson County. And also, I just wanted to touch on this. We also really need to get more membership, at least in private schools. It's really easy to get connections between different public schools because a lot of the counselors all know each other. It's a really great opportunity. Oftentimes, public schools do events with each other. And so there's a really great opportunity to connect in that regard. But one of the things that we want to start doing is branching out to schools such as FRA, BGA, BA. And I am already getting some connections at BGA. I have a friend at BA who may be interested in starting something up. But we want to make sure that this is something that can actually unite private and public schools. Because in the end, we're all united under one purpose, which is to help impoverished children and teens. That's our focus, and it's something that I know that we can spread, especially considering the amount of impact we've been able to have just last year and parts of this year.
That is a great question. So our volunteers come from all over the community. A lot of people came from Belmont, where I went to school, and students come for service hours. Different church groups come. A couple of Girl Scout troops have even come to connect with us to help sort through book donations that we get or to read with the kids for our reading days. But we're very much volunteer driven and always need volunteers for our reading days that happen throughout the Middle Tennessee area. If you're interested in volunteering, you can go to our website, just thewordwagon.com, or any of our social media platforms, and all of our events are on those platforms, and they typically happen on Saturday mornings from 8 to 11, and that really is because the kids are out of school, and so that more kids would come. But now we're moving into a transition where we're picking set locations to read on a regular rotation. So right now, when we're going with the food distributions, it's kind of a popcorn style, as I like to categorize it. So we're in Nashville 1 month. Next month, we're in Columbia. Next month, we're in Franklin. So it takes a while for us to get back to one location that we've been to in the past. And so what we're looking for now is different organizations to partner with that are already serving the community of which the children that we primarily serve are benefiting from their service. And so we're not trying to reinvent the wheel of kind of trying to find already, you know, communities that need this, and so reinventing the wheel of saying, oh, let's create an event and come forth. We've certainly done that in the past, but I think there's great benefit in seeing the collective impact that we can all have with the different organizations. So, for example, this coming Saturday, we have an event planned with the YMCA at their Margaret Maddox location in East Nashville. We have an organization, Begin Anew, that we're partnering with that provides adult literacy educational classes. And so then working with the kids, bridging that gap between the parents' education and the kids' education, education becomes a priority in the home. And that's a beautiful connection that we can provide. So volunteers are needed for all of those different events that we have. And again, they are posted on our website and our social media platforms for you all to check out.
So I wanted to see if anybody else had any questions that they'd like to ask.
Yes, so the kids that we read with typically are early elementary that we see most often, but the kids that we've seen throughout the entirety of the Word Wagon, anywhere from 2 years old to 12 years old. And pertaining to the books, through the bundles that we create, there are 10 books in all in the bundle that each child walks home with, and it ranges from board books to chapter books. And the intent with that is if they're at that board book level, they can start there and then grow in. And it's kind of like a home library starter kit, if you want to think of it that way, where they have many different levels that they get to walk home with. If they're at that chapter book level, they can then give back to their community of, you know, thinking, who could use this little board book that is about ABCs that I've already mastered that, but who can benefit from this as well? A baby cousin, a sibling, whoever in the community. And so with the specific book levels that we get, again, anything from board books to chapter books, Harry Potter, Lion and Witch in the Wardrobe, all wonderful books. I would say we have a great connection. We have a great collection of each category of board books. In each one, there's four different categories that we put in a bundle: board books, children's books, and then kind of that bridge between children's books and chapter books. So that in between, and then chapter books. I would say we get a lot of the children's books, but if you're looking to donate books to us, we would probably look more towards the books in between the children's books and the chapter books. So bridging in between the kids getting ready to say, I can read a chapter book, and board books where kids are just learning how to read the ABCs, putting letters together, which form words, which form sentences, and helping them through that.
That's a good question. You know, they're all so different. Every board is so different. And a lot of boards have to raise a lot. And then, like our board, we try to keep our budget relatively small because we feel like we serve all nonprofits. And we don't, and all nonprofits are looking for money. And most of the time, it all comes from the same pots of money in this community. So we try to keep our budget and our fundraising lower, but a lot depending on their mission and their needs. I mean, fundraising is definitely always the challenge. So really the truth of it is every board member has a responsibility to fundraise for that organization. And I say this to everyone who goes through our program, and so do our facilitators and speakers. You just got to know that if you're going to be on a board, that is a big responsibility of a board member. And if you don't want to do that, then you better, you know, maybe rethink where you want to give your community service, and it may not necessarily be on a board. But because fundraising is something an organization can't, you know, last without it. So I would say everybody has to spend some time if they're going to do their due diligence as a board member. And then some people probably spend a lot more than others. You know, it's just such a so individual to the nonprofit, so individual to how much money they need to raise, and so individual to how they do it. But it's a big part of being on a board for sure. Sorry, I'm not coming up with a specific number, but I guess that would really be pretty hard to do because it's also different, as I said. But it's definitely the huge part of being a board member, besides volunteering and helping and all the, and that's another thing, you know, a lot of people when they volunteer on for a nonprofit, it's all kind of warm and fuzzy. It's all kind of wonderful. I mean, because we all, you know, just like with Zach and Casey, you just want to go, we want to help that. We want to get out and do that. And then someone says, well, you've volunteered for this organization so long, you need to be a board member. And then they get on a board and it's not warm and fuzzy. That's not what they're dealing with. They're dealing with business and running the operation and making sure that they fundraise. So that's something I also say to people before you get on a board. You know, you have to realize that that really is what a board member does. You can still volunteer and get the warm and fuzzy, but on the board. So fundraising is a huge part of it. And I want one more thing. A lot of people say, I can't ask for money. I don't know how to ask for money. I don't want to ask for money. But it's not really just, first of all, if you believe in the mission, it's not really an ask for money. It's an ask for support and to think about what that organization's doing. You know, just like with Casey and Zach. I mean, people would give to that because they want to. So asking for money for these organizations would be a piece of cake, you know. I mean, maybe someone can only give $20, and maybe someone can give 25 coats, you know, but it's really not going out knocking on somebody's door and cold calling. If you have that passion in your heart, it's really not what you call hardcore, you know, going out to raise money, but it comes from having that passion for that organization. And if you're on a board and you don't have that passion and you truly can't bring yourself to ask for any money, truthfully, you need to think about, is this really the board I need to be on? Because if you all have seen passionate people like these two young people, if someone's passionate, people know it. And then they can just say, we need your money, or we're having a fundraiser or whatever. So, ooh, that was a long answer. I know, I'm sorry, but.
I'm 18.
I just turned 23.
Yes, Zach, you speak very well. I wanted to say that. Really enjoyable. You came up with the name Threads of Care. I can conceptually understand that. But when I think about who it is that you're targeting, both from, I'll say, an audience point of view, who it is that you want to help, and the other end is who you want to get the help from, what I think about is the one phrase you mentioned for the last part of your speaking, and that was teams helping teams. And I wonder, is that something that becomes a higher level of your being able to get the audiences you're really trying to attract? Threads of Care is kind of an interesting phrase to use, or a name, but it seems like it's maybe not getting the attention of the audiences you're really trying to grab. Maybe I'm wrong, but it just seems teams helping teams is really making sure your audiences hear who you are and what it is you're trying to get, especially, I'll say, in those private schools, where the first thing I can think of is the private schools say, thank you very much, Zach, we're going to do our own. You know, in other words, they're going to be competing against that positive, but it's not joining.
Okay, well, that's absolutely a valid point to bring up. And keep on to that point where you brought up about people competing. And at least in the stage of nonprofits, I don't really think of it as competition, because in the end, we all have a common goal, which is to help other people. At least in this situation, we're trying to make sure that we are helping as many impoverished children as possible. So if somebody wants to go out and start their own thing, I am all for that. Also, regarding the name of Threads of Care, the reason that we've chosen the name Threads of Care is because we focus specifically on collecting clothing and making sure that we provide any necessary apparel to impoverished teens. And I think that what makes this special is that we're not just trying to communicate to teens, we're trying to communicate to adults. I mean, that's the main reason why I'm here today, because as much as teens wish to help, it's also important to have adult support, because adults have so much more experience, at least in the for-profit and non-profit sector. And generally speaking, I don't know of many teens that have hundreds or thousands of dollars to give away to a charitable organization. So we absolutely need to be able to have a message which we're able to spread not just to teens in high schools, but also to adults. I mean, if we were just trying to spread it to teens in high schools, then I probably would start the Teens Helping Teens Club at Franklin. But when you're trying to create something that's so much bigger, I think that Threads of Care gives us the opportunity to have that mobility. And it also gives us an opportunity to work in extenuating circumstances where if we want to branch out and help a different group, we can. It offers flexibility, and so that's what I think allows for the magic of that name. And also just attaching that phrase of teens helping teens one thread at a time, it shows that each of us is part of a thread of this grand tapestry that we're trying to weave together, and it shows that this is really this excellent communal effort. So yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for your question. I really do appreciate that.
Zach,
yeah.
How and where do you distribute your clothing? Do you feel comfortable it's all given that can do anything?
Oh yes, absolutely. Well, we make sure to distribute our clothing to organizations which focus specifically on helping homeless and impoverished teens. And again, sometimes we work with organizations like Room in the Inn who also help adults, but whenever we work with them, we make sure that they're going to specific programs. So for example, Room in the Inn recently started a program where they offer teens the opportunity to come in and take certain classes there, classes in which they can improve themselves, learn how to look for a job, learn how to basically they take certain classes which help them improve themselves, and when they take those classes, they actually get credits. And then those credits they get, they can actually spend at a Room in the Inn store to get clothing that is donated. So it actually helps the teens that are going to Room in the Inn. Also, we donate to the Oasis Center, which focuses solely on providing relief to children and teens. So it's a really great opportunity to make sure that anything that we donate is going directly into their hands. And also, another special area that we focus on is providing new underwear and socks. Again, as I mentioned, that's something that's very difficult to get donated. And so we make sure to focus on that. And also, in the local Franklin community, I mentioned Franklin Special School District earlier. Recently, the PTO has actually started this really, really cool project called NOOK. That stands for Needs of Our Kids. And so what they focus on is making sure that they can, again, provide all of the necessary resources to the students that don't have those resources. It basically allows the kids to focus on learning while also receiving everything that they need. So we're able to fill the necessary needs of these homeless children and teens and of these impoverished children and teens and make sure that they get exactly what they need. And we do that by forming really strong partnerships in Nashville as well as strong partnerships locally in Franklin. We recently did have some people at Ravenwood High School. However, again, we did have some slight issues because, again, when you are a teenager, it's really difficult to have a lot of time for these kind of projects. And so a lot of the leadership that we had there, they were doing such a smorgasbord of activities that it's actually really difficult to make sure that we can find time to have these leadership opportunities there. And so we're actually looking to reinitiate Threads of Care there next year and make sure that we can have an even stronger impact, because Ravenwood is absolutely one of the top schools for donation opportunities.
And then quick other question, how are we into middle school? As you can tell, I have a high school and middle school, so there's an opportunity for them to, not their Girl Scouts as well,
Oh, yeah, absolutely. In middle schools especially, I think that that is a really great area of untapped potential, because a lot of schools in Franklin Special School District are middle schools and elementary schools. And so I think that we can definitely get a lot of middle school leaders. And just as you were mentioning how there was a junior advisory board, at least with the organization that you work with, I think that we could approach a similar model where we could have our high school board and then we could also have a middle school board. And I think that that would actually predispose a lot of students in middle school to lead this even more effectively, because my goal is to create something that students who come after me can expand upon and make even better than I ever possibly could have. My goal is to work with young people like me and make sure that we can build leaders throughout our community, because that will help them grow and it will also help whichever communities that they go into in the future. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Have you thought of your succession plan?
Yes, ma'am, I have.
Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, one of the things that I did last year was I drafted an operations manual. As you were talking, some of the work of nonprofits, this is the non-glorious nitty-gritty behind-the-scenes stuff. So it's about 20 pages long, really, really long, size 10 font, and I'm sure you all know that's pretty small, but yeah, so basically it has our succession plan laid out. I'm currently working with my deputy director. Her name is Sidonia Cannon, so that's a really cool name, by the way. But so Sidonia, I've been working very closely with her, and actually she is leading the upcoming shoe drive. So she and I are working with that. And by our spring clothing drive, which I don't have the date set out for that just yet, but by our spring clothing drive, I'm going to be transferring all power to Sidonia. And so she's going to be the person who's running Threads of Care. And so I basically laid out this one particular point that a lot of Threads of Care ambassadors have to do is that when they go into their high school communities, they have to, at least for 1 year, be willing to play an advisorial role to the next executive director. So when I'm in college, I'm still going to be connected to this, and I'm actually going to spread it wherever I go. So the goal is to make sure that I'm there for Sidonia, so that way if she needs any advice, like, hey, what did you do in this situation, or hey, something just rose up, is there any advice you can give, I'll absolutely be there for her. So she's going to be running it, but I'm going to make sure that I still am there that I'm still there and that I'm still present, so that way she doesn't feel like she has too much undue pressure.
I know that they will be here to answer a few questions afterwards if you want to talk with them. Or as I said, nonprofits and their organizations, they need support. It's also great, I think, if we wanted to talk about young people making a difference in our community, young leaders, it should be a life of service. So you have young children. Get them involved in having service as they can in their schools and their communities. Make it about being a life of service. And we just appreciate y'all being here so much this morning. Help somebody, that's what we all want to do. So thanks so much, and we'll see you.